that, and almost seems like I need to announce something else. What is the menu for
Finger Foods.
For the dinner on Sunday, on Christmas?
Finger Foods.
Just Finger Foods?
Yeah.
We're not having lunch?
Are we doing lunch? Then I don't know.
Well, it's after service. I'll work on that. It just takes a little while for the neck to turn the head. We'll work on that because that's Sunday afternoon. That's Sunday afternoon after the Christmas drama. So we'll talk about that. Also, if you notice something different this morning, instead of donuts, there was biscuits and gravy and I think oatmeal. And so the kitchen on Sunday morning will close at 10:15. No exceptions, it'll close at 10:15. And the reason for the switch from donuts is biscuits and gravy is better for you anyway. But what most people don't realize is that I personally spend a minimum of $50 a week on donuts. Donuts went up from about $12 a dozen to almost $17 a dozen. And I can feed biscuits. Sister Sanders does the labor, but we can do biscuits and gravy for less than one third. So if you take that times, you have a 5-week Sunday, that's $250. And so that's not coming out of church, that's coming out of Pastor Sanders' pocket. So, but I'm not getting cheap, but the thing of it is we, you know, gotta be wise. And truth telling, we probably don't need all that sugar anyway. And so if you want to have a little bite of breakfast before Sunday morning service, get here early. Amen. Get here early, and because the kitchen will close at 10:15, and maybe if we get started earlier, we can get out earlier. Evidently, nobody heard that. I said maybe if we get started earlier, we might get out earlier. That's just a by chance, but. Amen. How many is looking forward to what God has for us in this hour today? Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Weather's changing. Weather's getting cold. Amen. And so, same time of year. Praise God. Hallelujah. Let's all stand to our feet this morning. Amen. Praise God. If I could get... You want to announce that? What is it? You want to see? Okay. Be sure and buy you for the gifts in exchange. If you're going to participate in that in the gift exchange, please buy a mug or a cup, and they need to put something in it and put some candy or a pair of socks or something in there. As long as they're new and as long as they're clean, don't bring nothing used. And so, I'll be announcing all of that and get all the direction in that straightforward by next week. Amen. Praise God. If I could get my ushers up front here to get me. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. It's good to see D'Angelo today. Praise God. Let's talk to you. Missions offering up here as well, and I believe next week is the 11th, isn't it? Next Sunday is the 11th. On that Sunday morning next week, now don't stay home just because I announce this, but we'll be having a mission service next Sunday morning. Amen. A brother from Bolivia, and Brother Roberto from Bolivia will be here. Presenting their missions and their missions work there. And so be here, amen, to support that. Amen, with your attendance. Amen, praise God. Everybody get your tithe and offering in your hand. Amen, some have already brought it. Amen, praise God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. here and worship with us this morning. Amen. Don't be afraid of the front. Don't be afraid of the front. Looks like everybody's just moved up, sitting on the front row. So let's get on up. Amen. Right up in here and let's worship. Brother D'Angelo, if you'll scoot over to your left there, three or four steps. Amen. Give them some room right there. Amen. Amen. Let's get in the presence of the Lord this morning. Praise God. Hallelujah. Get in and worship the Lord.
I just want to see. go ahead and skip to My King Is Known By Love.
Glory to God. Amen. I have had numerous thoughts on my mind this morning. Amen. Thank you for your worship. I believe that we are on the eve of a spiritual explosion.
Amen.
Remember, tonight's service will be a baptismal at 6 o'clock. Amen. Right here in the sanctuary. Praise God. Can somebody shut that water off for me real quick? Just hot. It's on. Amen. I believe that we are on the eve of a spiritual explosion.
Amen.
Well, I'm glad about three people are excited about that. I'm going to say it again. I believe that we are on the eve of a spiritual explosion.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, it may cost us some natural comfort, but there we're, amen. I feel that something good is about to happen.
Amen.
Yes. Amen. See, we have a church culture in America that shuns the supernatural. Not under, it's on top. Thank you, Brother Chris. Just like a faucet. I said, we have a church culture in America that shuns the supernatural. We have worship services where we sing two or three songs, and there is singing, but very little worship. Most don't really want anything to happen. I just wonder what would happen if the Holy Ghost ever invaded the church.
That's right.
I said, I just wonder what would happen if the Holy Ghost was allowed to invade the church. He'll not invade the church without invading your life. Years ago, things used to happen that we couldn't explain. And a lot of that stuff was blamed on the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
Oh,
yes.
But people didn't want church to be weird. So we refuse to adjust things in the church culture. We have a tendency to swing the pendulum all the way in the opposite direction.
Yeah.
So now we've got worship leaders and worship teams and lights and smoke and sweet voices. But a lot of it is just clouds without water. It's a form of godliness with denying the power thereof. My biggest fear, you want to know, I'm not really a fearful person, but my biggest fear is that people will come into this holy, set-apart atmosphere and experience what is going on and leave here unchained. See, you think I'm talking about somebody who's come in addicted to drugs?
No.
Addicted to some kind of sexual misbehavior? See, that's the first thing that crosses a lot of sanctimonious people's minds. But I'm wanting you to change. I'm wanting me to change. I'm wanting us to change. We have turned our focus to everybody else around us till we have no longer become concerned nor convicted ourselves.
Right,
amen.
I'll tell you, if you missed Wednesday night's Bible study, you missed something.
Yes, you did. It's not just last Wednesday. It's every Wednesday.
Amen.
Yes, it is.
We got to talk about the fear of the unknown.
Yeah.
I'm so sorry, Brother Scott. Write this down. You'll be wanting to look at some scriptures because I think maybe the way the Spirit is leading me, I think it's 1 Samuel 17. It's not 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel. But our text this morning is going to come from a very familiar verse. It's going to come out of Philippians chapter number 4. Philippians chapter number 4 and verse number 8. Philippians 4 and 8 starts off with two words, Brother Gene, that every congregation likes to hear from their pastor. Finally, brethren. Stand to your feet, everybody. I want everybody that can, everybody that's physically able, I want you to stand on your feet. Because this morning we're going to do something different. You're going to read me the text. Glory. Philippians 4 and 8. Is it up there? Everybody got it? Can everybody see that?
Yes.
I'm going to get you so you can start off on number on three. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Finally, brethren.
Whatsoever things are true. Whatsoever things are honest. Whatsoever things are just. Whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are serving the Lord for, if there be any virtue, any praise, any things.
Now let me read it to you. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of a good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Everybody turn to somebody and tell them, think on these things.
Think on these things.
You can be seated. I mentioned this thought Wednesday night, and I have baked it in my spirit ever since. I want to preach on this subject today, on the power of your thoughts.
Amen.
The power of your thoughts. The beautiful thing about thought and thoughts is that thoughts have the ability to transport us from momentary situations of suffering and sorrow to a better time. Oh, amen. Amen. To a time that will be better. Amen. Thoughts have the ability to remove us from our surroundings, to remove us from hopelessness and despair and grief. Thoughts have the ability to literally transport us to another day. Amen. Our thoughts can take us to places of despair.
Yes,
that's right.
Even when we are currently surrounded with everything that we ought to thank God for.
Right, amen.
I'll back up because you missed that. I said our thoughts can take us to a place of despair.
Right, right.
Amen. Our thoughts, what can take us to a place of despair? Our thoughts can take us to a place of utter despair when we are surrounded by things that we ought to be thanking God for.
Amen.
Amen.
Thoughts can drag us down. Thoughts can beat us down and oppress us. That's the power of thoughts.
Amen.
Now let me clarify something to us this morning. Paul was not writing this book of Philippians from the Hyatt Regency or the Marriott. He wasn't writing the book of Philippians from a five-star motel or hotel. He pins these words while chained to a wall. says, finally, brethren, I want you to think on things that are true. Because after all, thoughts become the food that our minds devour.
Amen.
Oh, amen. 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 And what you devour determines not only your physical body, but what we devour as far as thoughts determines the health of our mind.
Right, amen.
I just got this spiritual feeling that I'm sitting in the midst of a bunch of sick people today.
Come on.
Not people sick in their body.
Right.
But people who are ill in their mind because the nutrition that their mind has been allowed, amen, to devour, it is corrupting our very system.
Right.
It's my obligation as a minister of the gospel to sell Jesus Christ and his plan and his purpose for our lives in here. But let me tell you, amen, if I preached, amen, 2 to 3 hours a week, may I ask you, what in that, what in the world is that compared to the countless hours and moments that we spend in front of a television, in front of the internet, on Facebook and Instagram and everything else involved in our life.
Right, amen.
I've got a job on my hands.
That's right.
I'm trying to steer us from this world to the glory world.
Amen.
And I've only got a limited amount of time and energy and resources in order to portray that.
Amen.
And to portray that to you.
Right.
Feel overwhelmed today. I said, after all, thoughts become the food that our mind devours. Pray for me, Mama, because I'm fighting spiritual warfare. The devil don't want us to hear this. Well, what you and I devour, not only, amen, affects our physical health. If all you eat is Krispy Kreme and chocolate, German chocolate cake, amen, people are going to see it on your physique.
Amen.
Amen.
What we devour as far as the thoughts determines the health of our mind.
Yes, it
right.
does. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Paul sets a table before them and he says, I want you to eat on things that are true.
Right.
Yes.
I want you to eat on things that are honest, things that are just, things that are pure, things that are lovely, things that are of a good report. He said, I want you to think on things that make you praise. I'm telling you, I believe with all of my heart, church would be different. Amen. If we feasted constantly on things that made us praise. Oh, glory to God. Amen. Oh, how different it would be. I want to think on these thoughts.
Amen.
It's nothing new. Keep that imagery in your mind of a meal being placed before you. Paul says when it comes to feeding your brain, this is the kind of stuff your mind needs to eat. Truth, honesty, just, purity, love, good report, virtue, praise. He says eat and devour these things. The Apostle Paul would later write to the Corinthian church and say in 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 3, 4, and 5, he says, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war. That's for 2 Corinthians 10, 3. Amen. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war in the flesh. Amen. I'm here to tell you, amen, we don't wrestle against people. Our enemy is not who's sitting on the next pew or the pew in front of us or the pew behind us. Our enemy's not our mother-in-law. It's not our preacher. It's not our wife. It's not our husband. It's not our children. I'm here to tell you, we wrestle not flesh. We do not war after the flesh. For the weapons. You see, the devil doesn't want me to preach this. Amen. Because I'm about to expose his secret. Amen. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down what? Imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity what? Every thought to the obedience of Christ. Paul not only said, Brother Ben, that our thoughts are food, that our brain eats, but he also says that our thoughts are spiritual weapons that you use to fight against the spirits of darkness.
Amen.
Right.
Amen. That's right.
No wonder you're so defeated. Because we're without any weaponry.
Yeah.
You don't fight the enemy with a gun or a fist or any other kind of device. When you get into the ring with our adversary, amen, you fight him with thoughts.
Amen.
Oh, he don't want me to say that. Amen. I said, when you get in, amen, in the ring with the adversary and the enemy of your soul, amen, amen, you fight him with thoughts, because he's trying to get your thinking, you thinking, and me thinking, and us thinking, the wrong thought. Amen. Listen to me this morning. You will never go the wrong direction until he gets you thinking the wrong thoughts.
That's right.
Right.
You'll never commit wrong deeds until you think the wrong thoughts. Boy, I'll tell you what, I just said something right there. Amen. Amen. So if I'm going to fight the adversary, I've got to understand that the battle is right here. Where's the battle? Somebody tell me. Where is the battle? I'll tell you, the greatest battleground is not in your living room. Amen. It's not in a boardroom. I'll tell you where the greatest battle is. The greatest battleground is right here in our mind. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ.
Yes, amen.
Oh, doesn't the adversary want to fill our minds with wrong thoughts?
Yes, he does.
Doesn't he want to speak to you constantly in order to get us thinking the wrong thoughts?
Yes.
He then plants. When he gets us in the wrong thought process, you know what he does? He builds a stronghold.
Yes, he does.
Yes.
He gets a hold on you, and he makes and develops him a place where he can work.
Yep.
Amen.
That's right, amen.
Amen. But the Bible says that we come against the enemy. Amen. That we think the right thought. And when we do that, we can start pulling down strongholds and cast the enemy out of our soul.
Amen.
Amen.
Right.
Paul not only said our thoughts are food. Let me just stop right here. Give you a commercial. You can't even hardly watch TV anymore these days without seeing some advertisement for some pill that's going to help your memory or your brain.
Yeah, exactly.
That's right.
Yeah.
Do you know you can get your vegetables and fruits in a pill?
That's right.
I'd rather have the vegetables and fruits.
Amen.
Amen. Don't get me started. Amen. And there are probably certain fruits and vegetables that can be devoured that would help us.
Yes.
You're right.
Amen.
If this is true, my friend, and all of you kind of look like you believe that, am I right, Sister Linda, that there are certain fruits and vegetables that are good for our mind and our memory? If that is true of the natural, hear this preacher of the gospel this morning. It is certainly true of the spiritual.
Amen.
If you can eat the right thing, I'm talking right now, Sister Joyce. If you can eat the right thing, you can get the blood to flow.
Yep. Amen.
And your memory will improve.
Yes, it will.
And your health will improve. And your energy level will improve. Oh, I'm not preaching dietary measure this morning. Maybe I am. If it fits, amen, wear it. Amen. Oh, you can eat the right thing, amen, and take the right thing in and get the blood to flow. And your memory and your energy improving. Amen. Then we can begin. If we can begin to think the right things, we can get the spirit world around us to begin to move again. Oh, glory to God. It's not because of the building. It's not because of a song. It's not because of a preacher. It's not because, amen, even of a congregation. It's because we are not thinking the right things. You don't have to say amen now. I know I'm preaching right.
Right.
Amen.
We are in a battle.
Yes, we are.
Yes, we are.
Amen.
Right.
We are.
Come on.
Amen.
If you're not fighting the enemy, you're not doing anything.
Right. Amen.
I said we are in a battle.
Yes.
Brother Ben, we're in a fight.
We are in a fight.
Right.
The enemy wants to beat us down and get strongholds in our life. I said from the very beginning, I believe we are on the eve, we are on the edge, we are on the cusp of God doing great things. Amen. I just wasn't talking about the 21st century church world. I'm talking about this congregation. I'm talking about this preacher. I'm talking, oh, come on now. If we can just get this fixed. Oh, yeah, there's some mental illness going on. And we need a healing. And we need a delivering. And we need a shaking. Thoughts are what are preventing it.
Yes.
Do you know you can think your way to victory?
Amen.
Yes, you can.
That's right.
Yes, you can.
Got three people that believe that.
Right.
So I'm just going to make an announcement to the rest of you. Do you know you can think? Who? Glory to God.
Come on.
You can think your way to victory.
Amen.
Come on, say it again. Did you know you can think your way to victory?
Glory.
Wow, glory to God. Not only that, Paul wrote in the book of Romans, the 12th chapter. And he tells us again that our thoughts are like food.
Yep.
Then he tells us they're like weapons. Then in Romans 12 and 1, he says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Verse number 2, and be not conformed to this world. Amen. Amen. That word conform means to conform oneself or one's mind or one's character to somebody else's pattern. Amen. Or fashion oneself, amen, to something else. Amen. Listen to this preacher this morning. Do not conform yourself to this world. This world is not my home. I said, do not conform yourself to this world. This world is not our home. The answer is not in this world. The answer for sure ain't in Washington. Amen. The answer ain't in Topeka. The answer is not in our legislature. It's not in our laws. The land, man, amen, human today, it's not in Congress. The answer is not in Joe Biden. The answer is not in Donald Trump. The answer is not in Ron DeSantis. The answer is not in the Independent Party. The answer is not in the Libertarian Party. The answer is not in the Democrat Party. Hear me today. The answer is in Jesus Christ. The answer is not in nuclear bombs, amen, or fancy aircraft. The answer is in God. The answer is in Jesus Christ. And our answer is in the Word of God.
Yes, it is. Amen.
But then he says, be ye transformed.
Come on.
Transform means to change into another form. To transfigure into another form. How do we do that? He tells us.
By renewing our mind.
By what?
Renewing our mind.
By joining a club?
Nope.
By joining an organization?
Nope.
By joining a fellowship? By joining a certain preacher? No. How is it done? Amen. Read it to me. Tell me about it. How is it done? It's done by the renewing of our mind.
Glory.
By glory. That you may go to prove that which is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. See, the battle is in your mind.
Right.
Am I helping anybody yet?
Yes.
I said, the battle is in your mind. There's some people that need to hear this, and they've vacated the sanctuary.
Yeah.
I rebuke that in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen. Thank God.
Amen.
Let me tell you something. The battle's in your mind.
Yes, it is. Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
Everybody say, the battle's in my mind.
The battle's in my mind.
Where's the battle at?
In my mind.
What's in your mind?
Battle.
The battle's in your mind. Change the way that you think and you'll change the way you live.
That's right.
Amen. Come on, right.
Right.
Yeah.
That's almost tweetable right there. I said, change the way you think and you'll change the way you live. The way you're living is not so much with the company you're keeping. The way you're living has a lot to do with the way you're thinking.
That's right. Amen.
That's right.
Amen, preacher.
Come on.
Amen.
Jeremiah, the prophet, Jeremiah 6 and verse 19. Jeremiah, the prophet, in Jeremiah 6 and 19, he said, hear, O earth. Anybody here live on earth?
Yep.
So he's talking to us.
Right.
Nobody here lives on Mars except Scott and Randy back there, they're the only two that raised their hands. They had a long trip to church this morning.
I think Kamala Harris.
Yeah, there's a few politicians that are living on some other planet. Here on Earth! This is God speaking. I will bring evil upon this people. What?
Even the fruit of their thoughts.
Because they have not hearkened unto my words, nor to my law, but have rejected it. You see, our thoughts produce fruit.
Come on.
You want to know where all this mass shooting and killing and junk is going on in our schools? It's coming from the fruit of our thoughts.
Right.
It's not coming from Smith and Wesson.
No.
It's not coming from Benelli.
No.
It's not, oh, come on now. Amen. It's the fruit of our thoughts. The problem in our society is the fruit of their thoughts. Amen. The problem with the church and with Christianity is the fruit of our thoughts. We determine what fruit it is. If it's fleshly, it's because you have fleshly thoughts.
Right. Amen.
If it's spiritual, it's because you have battled to have spiritual thoughts.
Right. Amen.
I'm talking about fruit.
Come on.
If the fruit our life is bearing is fleshly, it's because we're devouring fleshly thoughts.
Right.
But if the fruit of our life is spiritual, you thought I'd been sleeping under your bed, but I've been walking around in your mind now.
Come on.
You know what they tell me? They tell me that our brains are made up of kind of pathways. And these pathways are caused by our thoughts. Whatever we think, they say that a thought that goes through our mind is like pushing a wheelbarrow full of gravel across the yard. It's hard at first because the grass gives resistance. But if you keep pushing that wheelbarrow time after time after time until you wear a path, that it becomes easier to push that wheelbarrow on the path than it did when you first started.
Right.
I feel like preaching to you today. Amen. If you got time, I'll preach till your head falls off. Amen. Amen. And if you want to change your thoughts, you must realize that you've got to stop that thought right where it's at.
Amen.
You have to counteract that thought with another thought.
Come on.
You can't allow that thought to have authority.
Amen.
Brother Rusty, I woke up in the middle of the night this week, more than one night, casting out thoughts.
Amen.
I said, if you want to change your thoughts, you must realize that you've got to stop that thought right where it starts. You have to counteract that thought with another thought. You can't allow a thought, a bad thought, to have authority in your life, in your mind.
Come on.
That thought must be met with a higher authority.
That's right.
I said that thought must be met with a higher authority. Amen. You have to have the willpower and the brain power, amen, to meet that thought and keep on pushing it back.
Amen.
And I'm going to tell you something. It don't happen on the first trip.
No, it doesn't.
There's anybody in here under the sound of my voice that feels like you're not yet through living and you'd like to have your life back? You need to get on the bandwagon with me and let's start changing our thoughts.
Right. Amen.
That's good preaching, Brother Sanders.
Yes, it is.
If you're not through living yet, you ought to get on the bandwagon with me.
Amen.
Say, I want to change my thoughts. The fruit of their thoughts. God said, if you want to think it, I'll make you eat it.
That's right.
If you think it, you're going to eat it. The problem was that there wasn't any right thoughts. And because of that, there wasn't any right fruit.
Right.
Amen. Problem's not the singer, not the song, not the preacher, not the church. Problem's not our husbands, our wives, our friends, our neighbors. The problem's not even what happened to us in our past.
Right.
Come on. That's a good word right there. Say that again. Come on.
I said the problem is not our brother, our sister. It's not our society. It's not our church. It's not the preacher. It's not our spouse. It's not our job. It's not even our past. The problem is our thoughts.
Yeah,
right.
Thoughts are powerful.
Yes, they are.
Thoughts can move God into action.
Yes.
I said thoughts can move God into. How many need God to move in an area of your life?
Come on.
All right, this is why the enemy don't want you to hear this. Because thoughts can't move God into action. Something that we might think is insignificant, an insignificant thought moves God into action. I'll prove it to you. Genesis 6 and 5 says, and God saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. What caused God to change his mind? After 6 days of saying, it's good, it's good, it's good, it's good, it's very good. All of a sudden, God said, it has repented me that I've even made man.
Yeah.
But what caused God to swing into action and give a man named Noah a plan to build a boat? Because the worldwide flood was coming and all of humanity would be destroyed. What caused God to do that, I wonder? God went immediately to the root of the problem and he said, I've changed my mind when I looked at their thoughts.
Yeah.
And their thoughts were only evil continually.
Right.
That's the negative side. Let me give you a positive side.
Yes.
Thoughts can move God.
Yes, they can.
Go over to Matthew 9. Start about verse 19, I think it is, Brother Scott. Amen. There was a woman who had been bleeding for 12 years.
That's right.
Hemorrhaging.
Yep.
She was pale. She was sick. She was broke financially and in debt. And the Bible said in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 9 and verse 19, says, and Jesus arose and followed him, and so did his disciples. And behold, a woman which had was diseased with an issue of blood, 12 years, came behind him and touched the hem of his garment. Next verse. For she said, what is that if that's not a thought? She said within herself, if I but touch the hem of his garment. She had a thought.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank
you, Lord. Amen. Let me tell you something. Negative thoughts are contagious.
Right. You're right.
Yes, they are.
You didn't hear me.
Yes,
help me.
I said negative thoughts are contagious.
Yes, they are.
Sister Brown, that's why you can't afford to have negative thinking.
Amen.
But let me tell you something. While we're on this subject, you just get down about, I think it's verse 33 in that chapter, so Scott. Negative thoughts are contagious, but also are positive thoughts.
That's right.
Can I prove it to you?
Of course.
Can we prove it to you? Right there in that story of the woman with the issue of blood, I said negative thoughts are contagious, but so are positive thoughts. Verse 33, amen, amen. I think I'm going to go down to verse 36, but I'm going to go verse in time. And when the devil was cast out, the dumb spake and the multitudes marveled, saying, amen, it was never seen before. Matthew 14 is what I'm looking for. Matthew 14. Sorry. That was pretty close. I'll wait for you. There it is. Then they that were in the ship came and worshipped him, saying of the truth, thou art son of God. Stop right there. I said negative thoughts are what? Contagious? But so are positive thoughts. What did the woman, she had a thought about what?
Touching his garment.
Touching his garment. Go to the next verse. And when they were gone over, they came into the land of Gennesaret. And when the men of that place had knowledge of him, they sent out into all the country round about and brought unto him all that were diseased. Next verse. And besought him that they might what? That they might touch with their head the hem of it. Where in the world did they get that kind of a crazy idea? They got it from a woman who had a positive thought that said, if I could just touch, amen, the hem of his garment, amen, amen. And as many as touched were made perfectly whole. You can't stand here. I stand here today and tell you thoughts move God.
Yes, they do. Amen.
They do.
Amen.
If you want to move God, start thinking the right thoughts.
Right. Amen.
I'm looking for a transformed church in the next service.
That's right.
Actually, before we leave the service.
Amen.
I said thoughts can move God.
Yes.
Let me tell you something right off the bat. Our enemy, our adversary, Satan, the devil, Slewfoot, the accuser of the brethren, he is a master at trash talk.
Amen. Yeah.
Amen.
First Samuel 17, Goliath was a type of Satan. First Samuel chapter 17, verse 10 says, and the Philistine said, I defy the armies of Israel this day. Give me a man that we might fight together. When Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. Let me tell you something. The devil is a trash talker. He's not as powerful as some of us give him credit for.
That's the truth. Amen.
Give him too much credit.
He's only powerful if you let him.
Amen.
Or if you listen to his trash.
That's right.
Somebody's going to get victory right here.
Amen.
Come on.
You will never play your game in life as long as you listen to the trash talker.
Right.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
You'll never become who it is that God wants you to become as long as you listen to the trash talker.
Right.
That's right.
You know what a trash talker tries to do?
Get in your mind.
Say that out loud.
Get in your mind.
It's trying to get in your head.
Yep.
Ain't that right?
Yeah.
That's what a trash talker does. So here comes Goliath. I defy you! Send me out a man. And he kept Israel at bay for 40 days. Just trash talking. Help me, Holy Spirit. Are you sure you want me to say that? That's the reason some of you haven't moved for God in a long time.
There you go. Amen.
Because you've been listening to trash talk.
Yep.
Yeah.
You've listened to it trash talk saying they ain't no need to go to the altar.
Yep.
You've heard him trash talk. There ain't no need of trying it again. Who am I preaching to in here? Quit listening to the trash talking. Some of us are bolted to our pew right now because of the trash talker. Because the trash talker said, you tried that praise thing before and it didn't work for you. And he's trash talked you into not letting your praise go up before God. See, praise and visible and bodily praise is declared in the Bible.
Yes, it is.
It's all over there.
Amen. Amen.
Nowhere is there a sitting praise.
No, there isn't.
I've read the whole Bible multiple times, and I get to find a praise that sits still.
That's right.
Amen.
Raise your hands.
Come on.
Amen. Amen.
Right.
Laying prostrate, clapping your hands. The devil, amen. The enemy of our soul has trash talked us until we have bolted ourselves, amen, and refused to give God what God desires of us.
Amen.
Yes.
God, do a work today.
Look up the word praise. You'll find there's 13. Only 13 aspects of praise enlisted in the entirety of the Bible. Every one of them is using your body.
Amen.
None of them.
Oh.
Come on.
Oh my God, have your
divine
praise. Why are we bolted? Why can't we give God praise when God does? I'm gonna look this way. Does our God deserve praise?
Yes, he does.
Yes.
We clap for our children and grandchildren when they make a goal.
Yeah. Right. Amen.
I know Sister Sanders, when our children were in sports, she did for a Sister Whistler. She was. She almost got kicked out more than once. You wouldn't, might not believe this about my wife, Brother Ed. Amen. But one time she stripped off her glasses because of a bad call. Stripped off her glasses because of a bad call. And the ref was running down the basketball court. And she stuck them out across the line like that and said, you might need these. You might get thrown out of the building. Amen. Amen. Oh, yeah. I'm telling her right now. Amen. Because her boys were playing in a state championship. Amen. And she goes, oh, amen. So we'll clap for the U.S. soccer team. We'll clap, amen, for the likes of Michael Jordan. Amen. What's the Kansas City Chief quarterback? What's his name? Amen. Gonzalez or something?
Mahomes,
okay. Tells you how much I watch. Amen. We'll clap and we'll throw our fist and we'll give him a pump. Amen. When he makes a good play, but we'll sit silent. Amen. When our God, it comes time to glorify and magnify the one who gave himself for our sin. Why do we do that? Because the trash talker.
Right.
Has convinced us.
Yep.
I got too much preaching to do. I hope you got about 4 hours today.
Got it. Come on. Break it.
I'll tell you, 4 hours ain't nothing if it gets us power over the enemy in our life.
Right.
He's trash talk you into not letting God get your praise.
Yeah.
You'll give it to somebody who's receiving $40 million a year on a contract.
Yeah.
It's good preaching, Sister Noggle.
It is.
But a little boy named David came on the scene. And I think Brother Scott's in verse 40 in that chapter. It says, and he took his staff in his hand, chose him 5 smooth stones out of a brook. And he put them in his shepherd's bag, which he had, even in a scrip. And his sling was in his hand, and he drew near the Philistine. And the Philistine came on and drew near to David. And the man that bare the shield went before him. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David,
He disdained him, for he was but a lad or youth and ruddy, and of a fair countenance. And the Philistine said unto David, listen to the trash talker. Listen to him. Am I God? Thou comest to me with staves. And the Philistine cursed David and his gods, by his gods. And the Philistine said to David, come to me, and I'll listen to the trash talker now. And I'll give thy flesh to the fowls of the air and to the beasts of the field. Somebody give me the next three verses, the next three words.
Then said David.
Do what? Up to now, the trash talker's been talking.
That's right.
He said, I defy you. He said, I'll tell you what my dog? Am I a dog? That thou comest to me with a little lad? Amen. And a stave? And a stick? And a slingshot? Amen. Listen to the trash talker. He said, I'll tell you what I'm going to do, little fella. He said, before the day's over, he said, the birds are going to pick your flesh, and the beasts of the field are going to drag your carcass to and from the cave.
Right.
But what?
Then said David to the Philistine.
Then?
Said David.
Said?
David.
David. All right, can I give you my words? Then David said to the trash talker. Amen. Thou comest to me with a sword and a spear and with a shield. But I come against thee in the name of the Lord God Jehovah, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied. You got to counteract the trash talker.
That's right.
Years ago when I played basketball, Carthage, Missouri. I was not a center, I was a forward. But the center on our team was out, and they didn't have a sub. So even being not that tall, I could still jump. See that movie they put out, White Men Can't Jump? That's a lie, because this white man can jump. My younger years, Brother Sandy, I could stand flat-footed and jump my height. That's jumping now. Don't ask me to do it today. I'll break something. Brother Ed, I can stand flat-footed and jump my height. So because of my jumping ability, they put me in center for a tournament. There's this guy on an opposing team, Brother Randy. I said, you got to counteract the trash talker.
Yeah, you do.
He'd been telling everybody before our championship game, that little short Sanders guy, that he was going to dunk on him. So, even during the warm-up practice, he come up, dribbling that ball down there, jumped up, says, Daniel, whoosh, dunked that ball behind his head. So right before the game, I knew that I could not compete with that. I could jump. So right before the game, Ben, you know what I did? I went up to him and I said, hey, I said, rumor has it that you're going to dunk on this little short Sanders kid playing center. And he said, yeah, I sure am. And I told him this kindly. I said, go ahead and try it. But when you do, I may not be able to stop you. But when you do, I'm going to pull your pants down. You know what? We played the entirety of that championship game, and he never once attempted to dunk on me. Amen. Amen. We need to counteract the trash talker. The devil don't like what I'm preaching in here today. And we need to counteract the trash talker. We need to start shaming the devil. Next time he tells you that God don't care about you, you need to stand to your feet and shout, God cares about me. The next time he says God won't work for you, you need to stand to your feet and say, God's going to work a miracle for me.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I know there's more than one in here that needs to counteract the trash talker. You're in a battle. Okay, now we'll get into putting doctor's shoes on. You're in a battle, you're not mentally ill.
That's right. Amen.
Come on. We got people sitting on church pews taking more medication than people living on the street.
That's true.
Taking stuff to calm their nerves.
Yeah.
Taking stuff to put them to sleep, taking stuff to put them again, get them awake. All boys quiet right now, preaching that, now shout your shoes off. Amen. 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 The problem is not that you're mentally ill. Amen. You're in a battle.
Right.
The thing is, you're not about to lose your mind. You're in a battle.
Right.
Change your focus.
You're in a mental battle that you got to fight.
Mm.
Who am I preaching to in here? Fight. Fight.
Fight.
Fight. Fight. You're not going to lose your mind. Fight. Then the Philistine. Can I continue right here?
Yep.
Amen. The Philistine, watch it. Now he prophesies to David.
Yep.
He said, I'm going to give your flesh the fowls of the air and the beasts of the field.
Yep.
I'm so sick of the devil's prophecy over our life.
Amen.
Telling people that they've made too many mistakes for God to be able to use them.
That's right. Amen.
I feel like preaching. I'm sick of him. Oh, come on now.
Yeah.
Amen. Better listen up. Amen. Turn your hearing aids up. Amen. I'm sick of him telling the elder people of this church that you lived your life and you just need to sit around and be of no value.
No.
You might not be able to run the aisle or jump up and down, but when you bow your head in prayer and say, God, give our pastor your mind today. Keep your hand on God upon our church today. That's a valuable ministry.
Yes.
David said in 1 Samuel 17:46, he took a hike, so David didn't, but God did.
Here he comes.
David said, this day will the Lord deliver you into my hand.
Yep.
Verse 46. This day God will deliver you into my hand. Listen to every time he counteracts the trash talk. And I will smite thee, and I'll take thine head from thee, and I'll give it to the carcass to the host of the Philistines this day, under the fowls of the air and the wild beasts of the earth, and all that all the earth may know that God is God in Israel.
That's right.
Amen.
And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth, not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give it unto your hand.
Amen.
Under our hand. See, David counteract the trash talker. The trash talk of the enemy with the word of God.
Yes.
Yes.
True.
Amen.
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 He counteracted the trash talker with the word of God.
And he won.
David ended up killing Goliath with his own sword. Oh, I feel like preaching. This,
yeah.
I can preach every word.
Yes.
He did what? He ended up killing Goliath.
Yep.
With his own sword.
See, the stone didn't kill him.
No.
Knocked
him out. Go home and read the story. David, we sing that song in the children's church when I taught children's church. One little boy named David, only a battling brook. One little boy named David, five little stones he took. Huh? One little stone went in the sling and sling went round and round. One little stone went in the sling and sling went round and 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 round. And Sister Sanders, I need help. He let go of the sling.
Yeah.
The stone went in the air. And it says, and the giant came tumbling down.
Yeah.
The Bible says that he fell down face first. Pop.
Yeah.
Boom. But the stone didn't kill him. The stone didn't kill him. Bible tells us, read on. Bible tells us that David goes running down there. See, David didn't have a sword.
No, he did not.
But he reached into the sheath. Oh, dear Jesus, help us.
Yeah.
He reached into the sheath of the enemy and pulled out the enemy's sword.
Yep.
And cut the enemy's head off with his own weapon.
Yep.
Can I ask you a question? How does the devil come against us greatly?
In our mind.
So why don't we do like David and kill the enemy with his own weapon?
Come on.
That's the victory.
Amen.
David counteracted the trash talker. You got to fight thoughts with thoughts.
Amen.
I'm going to tell you something. The enemy don't want me preaching what I'm preaching today. You got to fight thoughts with thoughts.
Right.
Thoughts can make you miss your miracle.
Yep.
I'm going to close with this one. I got five more, but I'm going to close with this one. Thoughts can make you miss your miracle.
Yes.
1 Kings chapter 5, with Scott, verse 9 through 11, I think it is. Thoughts can make you miss your miracle. You know the story, you know it well. It's about that champion of the Syrians, Naaman. Bible says in verse number 9, 2 Kings, is that 1 Kings? I'm sorry, I probably gave you 1 Kings, I meant 2 Kings. Sorry, 2 Kings 5. 2 Kings 5, verse 9. Should start out something like, so Naaman, there you go. So Naaman came with his horses and with his chariot, and he stood at the door of the house of Elijah. Remember this story?
Yep.
The king, the head general of the Assyrian army had come down with leprosy.
Yep.
And he had an Israelite girl in his house that he had took captive as a servant. And she spots it. I preached a message years ago. I ain't never preached it again because they wanted to throw me out. I preached on. I used to do a lot of third person type preaching. And I was preaching on Naaman, where it says Naaman was a valiant man, but he was a leper. And I said, I want to beg you at a large preachers meeting at a conference. I said, I want to beg you preachers to go on a walk with me and let's climb into the chariot of a man named Naaman. I said, I want to do an interview with Naaman tonight. And I want to ask Naaman, what was your first sentence? And I preached on first sentence. It got so rough in there because the Spirit of God was so heavy. It wasn't me, but a pastor's wife sitting on the second pew put her fingers in her ears. And I said, it's not the sound of this PA system that's hurting your ears. It's the content. I talked about how Naaman said, well, I just didn't feel right. Naaman, his first sentence was, he said, I didn't feel right. Something wasn't right. Then he went on and he said, I just wasn't hungry anymore. I start talking about how people aren't really hungry for the Word of God. And how that maybe even somebody in here already thinks I've overpreached my bounds. I want to tell you something, we better get hungry again.
Amen.
The problem is, it's not the food's not being offered. The problem is, we have a sickness.
That's right.
And I preached on for symptoms. But this little girl, she said she saw it. She saw it. He tried to hide it, but one day it became visible. He couldn't hide it. And he said, well, she said, I tell you what, she said, there's a prophet in my land that can pray for you and God can heal you. So this is where it is. Naaman has got his chariots, he's got his gold, his silver, his gifts, and his servants, and he's went down. So Naaman came with his horses and with his chariot, and he stood at the door of the house of Elisha. I said, thoughts can cause you to miss your miracle. And Elisha sent a messenger unto him saying, go wash in the Jordan 7 times, and thy flesh shall come again to thee, and thou shalt be clean. You'll be healed. Next verse. But Naaman was wroth and went away and said, behold, I thought he'll surely come out and wave his hands over me and say, focus, the God of Jehovah and then the God of Israel be with you and you shall be healed.
Yep.
He said, I thought that's what was going to happen. But it didn't happen. Hear me, church. Quit waiting on God to do things the way you thought that he was going to do.
Amen.
Because if you don't, you just might miss the miracle.
That's right.
I'm not nowhere done. If I could take you over to the Gospels and show to you in the story of the prodigal son, I was talking to somebody, don't even remember who it was. But in that chapter, God gives us three stories. And I'm going to tell you, that has been one of the misconstrued stories of Jesus Christ, the teachings of Jesus Christ that have ever graced the church. He told, first of all, the story of a shepherd who had a lost sheep. You don't know how many times I've heard people misquote that scripture. He gave us a parable of a lost sheep. And the shepherd going and getting it. Said 90 and 9 won't do, but I gotta go get. So he gave us a parable of a sheep and a shepherd. A sheep was lost. A sheep wandered off. A sheep wandered off. The shepherd went and got it. Second, who remembers the second one? Was a woman in her house and she lost a coin. It's a parable of a lost sheep, a lost coin, and a lost boy. A lost animal. See, what that sheep represents is not you. It's not. What that sheep represents is sustainability. That sheep, Jesus was teaching in agriculture, about agriculture, how he's talking about value. So the sheep wandered, shepherd went and got the sheep. The woman lost the coin. She swept the house till she found it. That coin speaks of purchasing power. Yeah. See, I could preach today on how the church has lost all three of it. Then he tells about a boy who comes to his father, and you know, maybe I might preach this next week. I'll preach on the power of your thoughts today. Maybe next week I'll preach on the power of your decisions. The sheep wandered off, the coin got dropped. There's people in here that the problems, some of the problems in your life are not your fault. They're the fault of somebody who dropped you. Amen. Some people don't choose to fall into a drug culture. They're dropped into a drug culture. Oh. Then there's this parable of the lost boy. And the boy comes to his father and he says, give me that which belonged to me. You see, this goes down to people. See, this is the reason why this pastor don't chase after people when they walk out the church. That's not my job. That's not my biblical responsibility. Some wander off. That's the difference. Some are dropped. But it was the human being in this story that made a choice. Made a decision. And that boy, can I give you a revelation of the prodigal son? In the son of the story of the prodigal son, there is neither deity nor demon. There's not. I'm sorry. Yeah, we portray God to be that father, and yes, he has that characteristic. There was no preacher. There was no father. There was no Holy Spirit. There was no conviction that got on that boy in the pig pen. He made the decision to leave. He had to make the decision to come home. There's no moving of the Spirit in him in the pulpit. The Bible says, it doesn't say, and God spoke to him. You know what the Bible says? What's the Bible say for the rest of your Bible reading? It says, and he came to himself. And the Bible says, and he said to himself. That's not thoughts. What is it? And how many of my father's servants have got bread enough to spare? And
And here I am lusting after hogs. I'm going to tell you something. You may not think this is very good preaching, but I'm going to tell you something. If your thoughts can get you into something, your thoughts can get you out of it. Yeah. If your thoughts can get you into something, your thoughts can get you out. You may not give me any accolade this morning, but the Holy Spirit just whispered to me and said, listen, it's tall preaching. I believe God has given us the weaponry in this service today to defeat the enemy that has been ravaging our minds. I know I'm on target, sister. I know I'm on target. See, not everything has to be counseled out. Not everything has to receive therapy. I defy the enemy of my soul is telling somebody that you're mentally ill. You're not. You're just in a battle. You're in a battle. It's a fight, sister Bell. It's a fight. We're in a fight. We're in a fight for eternity. We're in a fight over eternal life. Whether we're rewarded or we're damned, we're in a fight. And you know where the fight is? Can somebody point to it? Where's the fight? It's our mind. It's our thoughts. You know why you get discouraged and stay discouraged? Because of your stinking thinking. You know why you get depressed and stay depressed? Oh, I'm not up here to boast myself and say I ain't never been depressed. I don't know that I have, but I probably have. There are times I've been down. I guess that's what you could call depression. But you know the difference between me not staying there and some of us staying there? It's because I counteract the trash talker with the Word of God. Every thought and imagination. I'm going to tell you something. The devil's going to work on you before you even get home. I promise you. He'll work on us before we ever even get home. But I give you the food and the weaponry through the Holy Spirit to be able to bring down those strongholds. Every service from this service on is going to be different. I said from the very beginning, I'm tired. The thing that scares me the most is that people will come in to this holy environment and leave unchanged. Because for that to happen means everything that has happened has been in vain. If you're under the sound of my voice and you honestly want change, I don't want nobody to be embarrassed. But I want some prayer warriors to get in your mind right now that you're going to pray for some people. If I preach to you this morning, you'd like to have a change. You'd like to have a change in your life. I'm opening up in front of this church right now. Thank you.